Osasu Ignatian and Ohimai Godwin Omaide.
Good morning, Nigeria. Good morning to our viewers across the world. It's 8 a.m. here in Abuja, Nigeria's federal capital, and you're tuned in to The Weekend Show, exclusively on Africa Independent Television.
I call it the biggest show on breakfast television. It's The Weekend Show coming to you live on AIT. Don't forget to follow the conversation as usual on our social media platforms at Weekend Show NG on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. The hashtag to use is hashtag Weekend Show NG.
Yes, we'll take a break right now, and when we return, we'll bring you the headlines of the week. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back to the program. Now we bring you the headlines of the week. So much has happened,
action
as usual.
Action-packed week.
Action-packed week. but let's just run through the headlines and we horn into one or two subjects if we have the time. Governor Aregbesola pays 19.6 billion arrears of salaries of Osun workers and retirees. The police also deploys 8 commissioners of police to Osun State ahead of the Osun Guber elections. China to take over Zambia's power company after defaulting on loan repayment.
And the big news of yesterday, Nigeria's finance minister Kemi Adeosun resigns. And President Buhari asks the former minister of budget and national planning, Zainab Ahmed, to take her place.
Yes, former minister of state. Very interesting. Also, Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos and his wife, Mackenzie, are creating a $2 billion fund to help homeless families and develop a network of preschools in low-income communities.
And the Speaker of the Federal House of Representatives, Yakubu Dogara, finally dumps the APC for PDP.
Yes, well, the APC reacted and said he's a lightweight.
Paperweight politician.
Yes, Nike's online sales jumped 31% after the company unveiled its Kaepernick campaign. Colin Kaepernick is the one who led the famous movement to kneel during the American National Anthem in protest of its lyrics and its meaning.
And of course, we also saw Apple unveil 3 new products, the Apple iPhone XS, the XS Max, and the XR.
Yes. Are you
gonna,
I think you should buy me one.
I want the tennis mask.
My birthday just passed. Your birthday
mine just passed. Mine is more recent.
Until next year. EFCC freezes 7 different bank accounts belonging to the Adeleke family, including that of popular singer Davido.
And of course, from Lagos, Ambode and his benefactor, Asiwaju Bola Metinubu, have disagreed over the 2019 re-election of Governor Ambode, although the governor has come out to say that there's no rift, but feelers from Lagos indicate that there's war.
Interesting times ahead in Lagos politics. Apparently, PDP has offered the Lagos gubernatorial ticket to Femi Otedola. There has been no confirmation from the party. But according to political chief Dendele Momodu, he said that Femi Otedola confirmed that he would be picking up that ticket. So very interesting at times ahead in Lagos. The Senate President, Saraki, continues his visit consultation to the different southern and eastern states, where he met with party delegates and executives to reiterate his determination to grow Nigeria.
And also, again, the big news that was spreading all through week, President Muhammadu Buhari appoints Yusuf Magaji Bichi as the new DSS boss.
This we will be talking about some more, but let's bring you the rest of the headline first. Fayose says, I will make myself available in your office come October. He writes the EFCC to lay low for the moment that he'll make himself available right after his tenure expires.
And of course, it's the season of presidential declarations, and the latest entrant in the race is former Ondo State Governor Olusegun Mimiko.
PDP. Forbes names Nigeria best economy in Africa. Interesting. Jonathan blames Oshomole or blasts Oshomole over vote-buying allegations. Saraki appoints Dorian Okupe as the chairman of his campaign media council.
And the international community paid their last respect to the late UN Secretary General, former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan in Ghana over the weekend.
Yes. May his soul rest in peace. Well, let's talk about one or two of these. I personally want to talk about the replacement of Matthew Saifa as the acting or substantive DG of SSS and replaced by another person from the northern part of the country. The federal character principle clearly states that there has to be a balance in the linguistic, tribal, ethnic, religious, gender, of people who are appointed into public service. So why is it that this government keeps on disobeying and breaching this principle?
But are you surprised? You know, there are a lot of people.
I tweeted that. I sent out a tweet the other day at my handle, Sasuik Benajan, that I am highly disappointed in President Muhammadu Buhari, that this was an opportunity to show your naysayers that, no, you're not
a nepotistic bigot person. Yeah.
And he disappointed me, but a lot of people tweeted back at me,
Osasu, why are you disappointed?
They said, your eye just declared after how many years? But, you know, I always like to see the best in our leaders. I believe that instead of engaging in insults, that we need to constructively criticize.
Exactly.
And as journalists, we don't have the liberty to come out and say, I'm for this person or I'm against this person.
Yeah.
And me personally, as an individual, I'm neither or. Like, I'm not for APC, I'm not for PDP, I'm just for good governance in Nigeria.
Yeah.
So when I see, and I wish the best for our leaders, because when we have a leader who can implement solid policies, we all benefit from that.
Definitely.
You know, regardless whether he's from the north, from the south,
from
or wherever.
And I think, one issue that nobody has really been able to decode with the Buhari administration is, it's the problem that the president doesn't really have good advisors. Or the problem is that the president gets good advice but refuses to follow those advice. Because right now, I can't even understand why the president would do what he did. And then just 48 hours later, but 24 hours later, appoints another northerner as the Minister of Finance. So clearly, the agitations or the tweets like from people like you was clearly lost on the presidency.
You see, I think when you take the mantle of leadership, to answer your question, I don't care if you have bad advisors or good advisors. You need to take responsibility because we voted you in.
The boss stops at your table.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And not your ministers, not your advisors.
Precisely.
Exactly. You are responsible for the actions that are taking in your administration. So I really found this very hard, breaking, because I hope the best for this administration.
I want
the APC to succeed. I want President Muhammadu Buhari's government to succeed, because that means a success for all Nigerians.
Exactly.
But when we keep on seeing actions like this being taken, it's...
The president's supporters have come out to say that this has always been happening in Nigeria, that under Jonathan, We had someone from the Niger Delta.
But they're microscoping the issue to just the DSS. 15 out of 17
security agencies
are head by people from the north.
From the north. Federal character completely discarded into the trash can of politics. I don't understand what's going on in Nigeria.
I feel like President Muhammadu Buhari, if you're watching, you should be up at this time. So if you're watching, please do something about this. It's
clearly
about time that your government has claimed that you're going to follow the rule of law, you're going to be transparent, you're going to lead this campaign against corruption. And when we hear stories like this, we just wonder, is the smokescreen of integrity that you've enjoyed for so long, is it finally going to be eroded? So it's something that you have to think, you know, and really ponder on within yourself, what is the next step for you? What is the next step for Nigerians? Is this a legacy you want to leave behind? So
we hope the president is watching, or at least the president's men are watching and they can relay this to him.
Yes. Moving on, Kemi Adeosun finally resigns.
I read the emotional letter she wrote.
Why do... See, I have a problem with that word emotional. Every time women express or send out, say, emotional or, you know, attribute some kind of emotion to it? I think it was very well written. Mm-hmm. I believe that she did the right thing. Yeah. But I was a bit surprised by the fact that she said she was just privy. She just became privy to the news that
an online medium once after.
investigated and saw that her certificate it was forged. But we really wish her the best.
Well.
I think she did try as a young, she's in her early 40s.
Yes.
As a young woman and taking on that responsibility as the Minister of Finance, I think she did give her best to it, and Nigeria will appreciate her for that.
Precisely. We hope we wish her the very best in her future endeavors.
We definitely do. Well, that's so much we can take on today's headlines. When we return, we bring you the lifestyle segment of the Weekend Show. Don't go anywhere.
So how with you, Delilah? You made me weak and left. Burning out, Delilah. You took my strength. You run away when I need your help. Oju ati ja o pada wale. You gonna call me like say you care. You gonna text me like say you care. Without you, I am fine, girl. Without you, I am doing well. Since you don't go, I am stronger. Feel me still, oh my love. I used to think you took my breath away. I lied, I was choking on your bullshit. Give me the strength to throw your heart away. You don't even deserve it. You do the lie. Girl, you white. Delilah, all I call made you.
All I call made you.
You do the
lie.
Girl, you white. Oh, the famous level. Oh, my love.
Welcome back to The Weekend Show. You're on to the lifestyle segment. And on this segment, we'll be talking about the Abuja nightlife scene. And I have with me in the studio this morning, Michael Egbu. Michael Egbu is a graduate of marketing from the Institute of Management and Technology, Enugu IMT. And Michael, thank you for coming on the show this morning.
Thank you very much.
Michael is the manager of Xtacy Lounge in Abuja, one of the biggest nightclubs in the city of Abuja. It's a pleasure to have you this morning.
Thank you.
We're going to be discussing about the Abuja nightlife scene. But before we have that conversation this morning, let's take a look at this video. We're going to be finding out, is drinking alcohol a sin? Let's take a look at this video. This video answers that question.
Drinking alcohol religiously. Islam condemns alcohol intake. Christianity also does the same. But we're African, for God's sake. To some extent, it's seen as a social, but it still largely depends on choice and health.
Yeah. Drinking alcohol, I will not say it's a sin, but don't be drunk. You can just like test it. But don't drink. But I'd not advise someone to drink alcohol at all.
Drinking alcohol is not a sin. You can drink as you can contain. Don't take too much. Everything is sin if you can take it too much. But when you take according to your capacity, it's not a sin. Drinking alcohol is not a sin.
It's when you drink it over. It will become a sin. Over one or two is okay. Yeah.
Drinking alcohol is a sin when someone takes it in excess.
Depending on how you take it, some might take it and you find them in the gutter. Some take it to prevent or cure some things in their body. So how you take it, it's how it works for you.
Alcohol, to drink alcohol is not a sin. According to the Bible, it's not a sin. But if you drink it the way the Bible says, drink it and control yourself. Not the one that you drink and start misbehaving, fighting people, falling in the gutter. That is why people say that to drink alcohol is not a sin.
Alcohol is medicinal in two ways around. Because some people take it for their health. Some people take it for their health. Some people take it for non-alcohol because it's not condemned in any way in the world. There is alcohol. It is not in Nigeria. It's not abused in any way.
Drinking alcohol is a sin in one thing. But the only thing is that why we make it, we now as a woman being, we make it to become a sin. Even the food that we eat, if you overeat it, it's a sin. So alcohol, drinking it is a sin to me, because it will not make you to lead well. When you drink, you misbehave. And which if you did not drink, you look the direction of the Lord to control you.
Oh my God, interesting reactions from Nigerians on the subject of is drinking alcohol a sin? Michael, quite interesting, right?
Very interesting.
You manage one of the nightclubs in this city of Abuja. How is the Abuja nightlife scene? How is it for you?
Well, Abuja nightlife is, I would say, is a good experience. It makes people to come out at night when they are free to mingle around, meet people, and associate at night.
Do people still come out?
Yeah, of course, people do come out.
Have we experienced an increase in the number of people that come out at night compared to what it used to be in the past?
For now, there is a slow in people coming out because of, I would say, the economic situation of the country at the moment. Mm. The inflows of money is not like the way it used to be before. Based on that, it's not as before, not as usual.
But people are still popping.
Of course. Of course.
Interesting. So tell us about your experience being a nightclub manager.
The experience is quite interesting because you get to meet people of different walks of life with different character. Some cool-headed and while some, want to show you off the stuff they are made of and all that. But then, in generally, I think it's a good experience.
So how are you managing competition? Because I know that the Abuja nightlife scene is very competitive.
Yes.
You have so many clubs in this city. And what is that unique thing about Xtacy that makes it stand out?
Xtacy has been in existence for some time now. When you come to Usetu in particular, I think Xtacy is one of the oldest. So it has made name for itself. And the services of Xtacy too stands out. Because Xtacy has been in existence since 2009. And being in a very strategic location in Usetu, that is Aminu Kanu, by Agades, the club has really made name for itself. Mm. And the services there, there are customers to testify. Even when they try to try out other clubs, they still come back and say, we render good services. So I think what to offer our customers are very unique.
Okay, so do you just focus on alcohol or you sell other things apart from alcohol?
It's all about entertainment. We entertain our customers, make them feel more relaxed, make them feel at home. You know, after the day's work stress, some people need to chill out at night and feel more relaxed. So when they come, they listen to good music, get one or two shots of alcohol, maybe to relax the body. And when they feel like dancing, of course, they dance. And that's just what it's all about.
So let's talk about the general view of Abuja nightlife. How safe is it to come out at night in Abuja today?
It's very safe. It's very simple. I can say.
You know, we witnessed an incident where someone was shot. A lady, a copper, who was just finishing her service. They went to club and they were coming back. She had gone for her POP party, and then she was returning with her friends. Yeah. And they were stopped at the police checkpoint. They refused to stop, and they fired a bullet, and she got killed.
I would say that's a misconception. There's a misconception somewhere there because had it been they stopped, and they were properly searched, I don't think that will occur.
But don't you think this has created this? Very dangerous atmosphere around coming out at night in Abuja, especially with the increase of police presence that we have witnessed in the city of Abuja recently?
As a matter of fact, the police presence will make you feel more safe.
Really?
Yes, because if they are not there, that is when it is more risky. Yes, but with their presence, of course, you are very free to move around as long as you are clean, you don't have any cockroach in your cupboards.
So people are safer with police presence than with police not being around? Because we've seen also a lot of complaints from young Nigerians about SARS. SARS men, you know, arresting people. Hey, what's on your phone? What do you do for a living? Why are you driving this car? That happens a lot.
Well, that of SARS, I wouldn't say because I've not had an experience with them.
And you've not had customers who have had experience with SARS?
I have none. None have complained about SARS. The ones we've hired is our police, of course, and what they do is basically stop and search, which after that, if you are clean, you move ahead. I've not really witnessed or seen a situation where the police is harassing people that are going on a night out, especially in the Abuja Metropolis.
Let's bring it back to the nightclub life. We've had cases of people spending at least between 4 to 5 million a night on bottles. What's the highest you've ever had in Xtacy as a manager?
Well, recently now, business is not as good as it used to be.
But when it was
those
good,
days,
tell me when it was good.
When it was good, of course, people do come and people that make money, maybe they come into the country and they want to show off. They just arrived and they maybe they have some people to impress. You know, they want to like pop up some champagne.
So you've actually seen someone spend up to 1 million on alcohol in a night?
Yeah.
And even more than that.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Interesting.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Wow. Abuja nightlife. Okay, well, we've been talking about Abuja nightlife, and with me in the studio has been Michael Egbu, who is the manager of Club Xtacy in Abuja. We've been talking about the overall nightlife scene in Abuja, and it's been quite an interesting conversation having you on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
The weekend show continues shortly. Stay tuned. We'll be back with the lifestyle segment.
My name is Blessing. I was born 1977, September 28, 1977. I been do business before for Maraba. My money collapsed, so now my friend. Now she tell me, say, somebody want rent this place. So I come. That's how they start the business. The way she tell me, say, money die, come, I no see the money. I no see. Problem, problem. Nowadays, anybody come, they excuse, Some go come. Then get children. The children, they go school. The husband know they work. Some, the reason why they come. Some go come. Say, then they fight for their place. The reason why they come. Excuse. Their own problem come, they pass my own. I be woman. I the pity too much. So the business, I don't see anything at the gain. I know they see anything for the business now. I know they see anything for the business now. The problem then they explain past myself. Three of my guests here, they school for Gwagwarada. Them, ma, you go know her person day jungle, they school. They go school. Say parents, they no train her for school. Now she, they train herself for school. Sometimes they go, come give me excuse. I go still consider. Maybe tomorrow that person will help me because I don't know say, this business I go do and before. Now the condition I make me come rent the place. Excuse too much. Not only NGO, they
I call you baby. Some people don't know I call you baby. They say I'm crazy. No be my photo, you drive me crazy. You get that shit they do me. I carry on my top on my head. Oh yeah, for me, so the red. Baby, me show color red. I got show, see I'm feeling you. I go follow you as you dey follow me. And they guys know say that me and you. I wanna show you up, show you what's good on me. I know shy guy, oh no. You are the one that I like. And anybody wear mine, oh. Waiting then they find, oh. Money more bad,
money more bad.
Where I don't care,
I don't care.
You want more bad,
you want more bad.
So I don't care,
I don't care.
Money more bad,
money more bad.
Welcome back to the program. Joining me now are Chioma and Bolanle, who are also media girls like me. Welcome to the program, ladies.
Thank you.
You're most welcome. Our conversation today, my co-host recently, just had a conversation with the manager of one of the nightclubs in Abuja, who was discussing Abuja nightlife. So our conversation now is also related to that, the rising trend of prostitution in Nigeria. My team and I carried out a research, and we found out that at every corner nowadays, and not just at night, you know, you find women standing there ready to prostitute. So what would you attribute that
I
to?
See, this is the that's the topic now. We can see it. Everything is about it.
The situation in the country, people think that things are hard. Just this person, everyone has to survive. And then it depends on the choices you make. Like, do you want what do you want to do? Some people feel like there are no jobs. So the easiest thing to do is sell their bodies to, you know, get money to survive. Then again, somehow, our society doesn't quite help, because even if they go to meet someone for help, a man, the man will be like, okay, fine, I can give you this, but
what do I get in return?
So at the ending, it's like, all I can just do is just to sell my body for money.
But you see, I've noticed, or if history teaches us, that there's always been hardship in the land. So what is attributed to the increase? Because nowadays it's alarming.
You press the right button on that
one. Before you see,
you're taking the volume off.
The middle-aged person from 40 and above, prostitutes is usually hard. It's almost like you have
I think it's
trying to keep your family together, and then state of living now is on the high side. So you're thinking, how do I survive? Fine, a lot of us are learning one or two skills, so you don't have to go into that business, because not everybody's caught up for that. And then secondly, I think it depends on your
upbringing as well. There are other means for you to make money, to earn a living without prostituting. But prostitution is like the easy way out for most people. Like, let me just do this and just get my money. So at the end of the day, you're like, is it really the easy way out? So if the economy is good, which is one, we have jobs available. And then even if you have a business or a skill, something you want to do as an entrepreneur, do you have the funds available to help you? It takes you back to it. Like, if you get people that can sponsor you, if you get people that can help you out, it's always a give and take situation.
Yes. And as Chioma said, it's like when you reach out to someone, oh, please help me, their response typically is, what do you have to offer me in return? So most women feel that they have to be subjected to such cruelty and abuse. And I think another thing that we must discuss is also the pressure now from society. You have I mean, Apple just released 2 new iPhones. So I'm sure there are college students who are thinking, oh, I must get the latest iPhone. I must get the latest Samsung. I must get the latest this. How do we curtail such exuberance? How do we curtail such, you know, excesses in our youth, in our women?
Well, first of, thanks to my mom, the way I was brought up, I remember coming back home one day and I told my mom that a friend of mine got a new toy and I wanted that toy. The first thing she did was to beat me. And then she sat me down and told me that because she has it, doesn't mean you will have it. You should be okay with what you have. You have something like that, just that it's not like as new as hers. So somehow I always had that behind my mind. So even in school, they will tell you that that when everybody's buying stuff, I'm just looking at
we
you
don't
like,
care.
Okay, that's fine. So I feel like it's something that has to be taught like from childhood.
Contentment.
No, yes. And then some people actually give in to peer pressure.
Yeah, peer pressure as well. Like,
everybody's using it, I want to use it. I, for one, I'm not an iPhone person. So if you come and you tell me iPhone X, like, a friend of mine took a picture the other day with his iPhone, and I was like, oh my God, the camera is nice. Like, I like this phone already. And then I was like, how much is it? And he told me, I was like, oh, okay. It's not for
I'll
me.
I'll be right back.
You know what I mean? So, like, at a point, you have to learn to just be okay, be satisfied with what you have. Like, if you're meant to have it, you have it. If you don't, I mean, you survive.
But how do you preach that to young ladies who necessarily didn't grow up with much? Because we had a conversation with a couple of women who were standing on the street, and we asked them, this is a judge-free zone, just tell me your story. And one of the girls said to us that her mother is sick, her father is sick, she's in school trying to pay her way through university. What else do we expect her to do? That there's no work, there's no opportunity for her to make money apart from prostitution. But we also saw her carrying an expensive phone, an expensive bag. So it's, how do we, where do we draw the line between, okay, you've grown up having such a, you know, massive need, and now that you're finally working, you're able to get those things for yourself. But how do we, you know, sort of move that to a legalized area where she can actually do work that's productive and not and doesn't endanger her life?
Number one, what is she doing to develop herself? Aside prostitution, is she actually gaining value, like adding value to the society? Is she learning a skill? You can't tell me because your parents, both of them are sick, and you think you don't have a choice, you're prostituted. Hello, there are a lot of organizations out there that are hiring freelance people. You can go there and tell them, I want to work, I want to learn this skill. Then when you acquire this skill, you get paid for it. That's how it works. There are NGOs, they're ready and willing to take people. I think Nigerians don't even know about it. There are volunteer jobs as well. You can go and learn skills without, tell them, I don't need your money. Trust me, less than 6 months, they will pay you. Even for freelance, they pay nowadays. So if she feels she had, I didn't grow up with a silver spoon. I had to hustle. Like from after secondary school, I entered the market, I started working. My mom was against it, but I had to work because I needed my cream and my toiletries, and Popsy was not around to give me money for that, so I had to go and look for something to do. I didn't decide to prostitute because I wasn't brought up that way. It wasn't even a choice. It wasn't an option to me. So I decided to learn other things. So you learn certain skills, you volunteer yourself, you learn a trade, and then she gets the money, she goes to buy a Gucci bag, iPhone X. Really? And your parents are sick?
And you see, another thing now is, even aside the prostitution, because we know that in several parts of the world, a lot of countries are starting to legalize the profession of prostitution. They create these hubs where men can come and do their thing and leave, and it's actually legal. So with the people who weren't brought up the same way the three of us were brought up, mm-hmm. they have their parents telling them, just make money whichever way you can and bring it home. Do you believe it's fair enough for the government to look at this ideal of legalizing the profession of prostitution? Isn't it just like any other profession?
Well, I'll come at this two ways. A bit controversial right now, but I'll come at this like from two ways. The first way is, first off, okay, if you're going to come from the religious point of view and the moral standing point of view, prostitution is sin, so is fornication, so is adultery.
Every other
so
thing.
Is lying. Every other thing. And the truth is that if you're we can't just pick and choose what we want to deal with. Mm. So first off, the rate of immorality is high. The rate of fornication is high. The rate of adultery is high. Now, a married man would still go out to go and sleep with some girl out there. Mm-hmm. Now, this girl will not be tagged a prostitute because she's not standing by the road. Yeah. But she's sleeping with this man because she's money. Getting some things from him. Mm-hmm. Whether it is money, whether it is a home.
And those ones have different names. Those are called runs girls.
Whether it's a home.
And I have to ask, runs girls and prostitutes, are they the same?
These are the same thing. Well, it's just the name.
They're the same thing. I'm just saying.
They just changed it to make one look posh.
So now, the thing is this, if you're going to say, let's legalize it. Well, this is a bit.
Say
this
it.
Is my opinion.
It's okay, the weekend. Fine. You can say you can say practically anything that doesn't breach the NBC code.
Okay. The thing is this. I feel that I'm not going to say legalize it, mm-hmm. to be honest. But at the same time, I feel like why is there a debate of legalizing or not? Why it's a debate of it being legal or illegal?
Illegal.
Because the point is that these people have sex anyway. Mm. Those who are kicking against it have sex anyway, outside their marriages or even fornication with girlfriends or not girlfriends or random girls or people they meet in the club, one night stands or whatever. Whether you give money for it or they don't give money for it, it's still a sin.
Exactly.
I'm just saying it.
So you're saying legalize it.
I'm just saying there shouldn't be a debate on if it's illegal or
no,
legal.
The reason there's a debate is because giving our laws today, if a prostitute is found wandering or selling her body for sex or whatever, or doing her business, they are meant to be arrested.
So what happens to the man soliciting for it though?
That's another thing. Should he be arrested as well? That's why we're having this debate. So should it be, as you said, since everyone is, well, everyone, but at one point or the other, if you especially bring that religious perspective to it, we're all sinning in one way or the other. So should it be legal? Should everyone be allowed to,
I think seriously, we're Africans. Forget the fact that we're trying to be westernized, we're trying to act all white, and they can legalize it in America and London, but in Africa it's hard. Let me tell you why. Wait, our values, our cultures, come on, can't just tell my dad that my friend is a prostitute. Come on. Let's be serious, in this country, some of them are doing it, they have legit reasons for probably going into it and they're making a living from it, but I always feel you have other options. You have other options. Mm. To me, it's not the last thing you can resort to. There's never a dead end for me. You keep pushing. There's something else you can do. So you can't come home and tell your dad that, okay, I think I'm going to be a prostitute and stuff. The government is not even thinking about legalizing it. Come on, see the issues we have over same-sex marriage.
But as you said, so many people are doing it. So why do we keep on pretending like it doesn't exist?
Human beings are like that. You don't want to. You don't want the truth to hit you in the face like this. You know it is wrong. You know this person is doing it. But don't put it in a tag and put it on your breast that this is what I do. Prostitution is not something you carry on your
breast. So while you may not be able to go home and say, Daddy, Mommy, I have a friend who is a prostitute, you can probably go home and just your mom, do you know this, my friend, Amaka, is a runs girl? Or do you know
Amaka will not see. She doesn't want to see her with you again. Don't try that. Don't bring Amaka to the house again. I'm telling you.
My thing is, first, you said something about westernizing. I think it's unfair to them because they too, most of them or some of them, still have issues of
prostitution, like some of them are against it being legalized or not. So it's not their culture. You can't say it's their culture. It's not their culture. It's a worldwide issue. Some countries have decided to just, you know, legalize it. But the point is that as human beings, we are created with choices. You are like, but every choice that you make has a consequence. Now, the point is, we sin every day. We know that what we do is sin, but we still choose to do that. So I feel like it boils down to giving everyone the, like, the freedom to choose what they want to do. But if you choose to be a prostitute, you should know that these are the consequences that follows after this.
Chioma, Bolanle, that's a fine place to leave it. Thank you so much. The debate is ongoing. Legalize, illegal, prostitution. Let's hear your comments and your thoughts in this. Tweet us at Weekend Show NG on Twitter. Follow us on Facebook or like us on Facebook. Drop a comment and follow us on Instagram as well. We'll take a break right now. When we return, we'll bring you the political segment of the weekend.
Oh.